Okay. So, we are going to discuss attitude control using Lorentz force. And I am going to basically talk about things that are being done here by Professor Sinha's group. Okay. So, my contribution here is zero, but I am just going to present the material that I have been provided. So, I thank Professor Sinha for his kindness. But I before I go to the slides, I want to say a couple of things about the basic principles, which is slightly more than this type of approach that Professor Sinha has. Now, Lorentz force, first of all, what does that mean? Okay, what is it? So, when you have, let's say, a charge that is moving in a magnetic field, a force is generated, and it is called Lorentz force after the great physicist Lorentz. So, if you have, can we have the, So, if you have a charge Q that is moving with velocity v, so this is the charge, and it is moving with velocity v, this is the velocity of the charge, and it is cutting a magnetic field. This is the magnetic field, the same magnetic field that we had in the first hour. Okay. Then we have a force is equal to Q times V cross B. That is the, this is the Lorentz force. Okay, this is the principle. Now, there are two situations here. You could have electrostatic or electrodynamic. Same Lorentz force, but you could have a static system or a dynamic system. So, for example, you may have, let us say, a satellite, and you have some charged body here and charged body here. So, you have Q here, and is moving around the earth and cutting the magnetic field of the earth. So, you have this Lorentz force generated. So, that is, this is an electrostatic situation, but you may have also another situation. Let us say you have a satellite and there is a tether here, long tether, and then there is a body over here, and current is flowing. Current is flowing in that, and this is cutting the magnetic field. So, here it is not a static charge, but you have a current. Okay. Again, you have also the Lorentz force developed. So, basically the same thing, there is a movement of charge, motion of the charge cutting the magnetic field. And then again, you can have a force that can be written in terms of, let us say, I dl cross v b. It's the same thing, similar to that. Here you had the static charge Q. Here you have actually this I, but you will have an expression something like this: I dl cross B. So both are actually based on Lorentz force principles, but this one is electrostatic, while this one is called electrodynamic case. Because here the charges are moving. Now, a current can flow also, because it is when you have a satellite moving around, you can actually develop charges here from the environment, and this can flow over here, and whether the current will flow upward or downward, that will depend on, you know, the voltage difference. You can actually change the direction by applying a battery, by using a battery. So, you could have I up or down, and once you have up and down, your direction of the force also will change. So, you can use this to get a force acting on this. The force can affect the attitude dynamics, force can also affect the orbital dynamics. So, you could actually have an orbital raising or orbital lowering depending on the direction of the current. So, both of them are based on Lorentz force. Okay. What we want to consider today, is this electrostatic actuators for specifically attitude dynamics. So, ignore this, this is presented by me, but provided by Dr. Sinha. Okay. All right. So, I am going to discuss this material, and this material will be very familiar for people like Vijay, but for other people, you know, I want to do that. All right. So, we are going to talk about magnetocoulombic attitude control. It is magnetocoulombic because, you know, you have the you have Lorentz force, you know, there is a Coulomb action, then there is a magnetic field, it involves the magnetic field. So, we are going to discuss some of the fundamentals of magnetocoulombic attitude control system, and there are lots of slides in this particular file. We were not going to have time to discuss all of them, of course, in detail, it is not possible, but at least we will try to do whatever we can and show some results. But there are lots of proofs and theorems and proofs, we are not going to deal with those things. Okay. All right. So, we have these as the contents of the presentation. Some introduction, magnetocoulombic attitude control, then finite time continuous sliding mode, magnetocoulombic satellite attitude control. Now, how many of you are familiar with sliding mode control? Have you heard of that? You know, can you raise your hand who has studied sliding mode control? Okay, three of you. Okay. And then fault tolerant attitude control, you know. Okay. Now, this motivation is not motivation related to why you use Lorentz force, but is motivation behind this particular work. Okay, well, that was done. What it says is that there is, you know, this is a problem, residual magnetic torque. There is always residual magnetic torque in the satellite, which causes some problems, leaves rooms for uncertainties. Okay. It interferes with the sensors and instruments. In fact, we also talked about in the first hour, when you use magnetotorquers, there can be problem interfering with instruments, and here also we have similar things. Okay. And charging of the satellite due to interaction with charged particles, so this is another issue here. So, in order to address these issues, okay, which cause numerous problems, we are going to use the approach that was followed by Dr. Sinha. And is this Vijay, who are the people who did this work?
Deepak.
Deepak, okay. Right, I have seen his thesis, Deepak Giri. Okay. All right. So, as I said, the Lorentz force is produced due to the interaction of electrostatic charges on the satellite and terrestrial magnetic field. As I said, you know, if you have a static charge moving in a magnetic field, you have Lorentz force. But even if you have a current, that also produces a Lorentz force, it's the same thing. Okay. But we are dealing with, we are going to consider this electrostatic charges. Okay. And in this analysis, basically what is being done is that a rigid body, a rigid satellite is being considered, satellite is modeled as a rigid body, and is moving in a circular orbit, and then the Lorentz force produces a torque. Lorentz force acts on, you know, when Lorentz force acts when this satellite is when the charge is moving, and by arranging these charges in different places, you can actually then determine what kind of torque will be produced around the center mass of the satellite. So, this torque due to this Lorentz force, this is magnetocoulombic torque, and we are assuming here that this is the only control torque available. There are no other things, you know, no magneto torquers, no thrusters, nothing is being applied, only this torque is being applied. And what is also being assumed that you know, you have a system like this. So, if this is the satellite, so you are then having some shells where you have this charges here in the x direction, y direction and z direction. So, we have these charges. You apply, you know, you have these charges so that, you know, you would be able to obtain torques in all three directions. So, we have three pairs of charges placed along different body axes. And in the analysis, dynamical analysis, gravity gradient torques are considered both favorable and unfavorable. Sometimes gravity gradient torques help, sometimes they make it unstable. So, both are being considered here. And the higher order terms in the gravity gradient torque model are not considered there, because it is not necessary, they are negligible and make the analysis very complex. So, higher order terms are not considered. The higher terms can come from nonlinear terms, which can be neglected. There are also gravity gradient torques which are related to the non-spherical shape of the earth, but you know, they contribute also to the gravitational force and hence to the gravity gradient torque, but they are also very small. So, all these are neglected, only linear gravity gradient terms for a spherical earth are considered in this study. Okay. So, this is the equation, this is written in matrix form, you know, this is Euler's equations that we wrote, you know, we wrote Euler's equation in scalar form, and so this is written in matrix form, this is the inertia matrix. This omega hat over there, this is the vector of angular velocity components omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. And as I said in the first hour, quite often you put this tilde to show that this is a column vector. So, a physical vector with arrow, column vector we represent by this tilde. And this S, this is the skew symmetric matrix, the way we had are defined in the first hour, it is the same skew symmetric matrix, and the skew symmetric matrix has an argument. So, when you put here B as we had in the first hour, so we have the components Bx, By, Bz appearing, or B1, B2, B3 appearing. When you have the argument as omega, so we will have omega x, omega y, omega z appearing in the skew symmetric matrix. So, this one, this is equal to that. Is equal to the external torques, that is the Euler's equations of motion. This product terms of omega 1, omega 2, etcetera is equal to the external torques, and the external torques that we have here is the gravity gradient torque. The gravity gradient torque is proportional to the square of the orbital angular velocity, here it is represented as omega naught. And then we have actually the same skew symmetric matrix as we have for omega, as we saw you know, in the previous lectures. We have those LMN, the direction cosines of the radial vector appearing in the gravity gradient torque. So, here is the same thing we have there. This one here will give rise to your inertia terms multiplied by those LMN. And the differences between inertia will come out. If you evaluate this skew symmetric matrix and then take the product matrix product with the components of this Ex here, Ex vector is the radial vector. B here is expressed in body term, body frame, and that is what we did also in the previous lectures. So, this is your gravity gradient torque, this is the disturbance torque appear that can arise due to solar radiation or aerodynamic drag or whatever, and this is the control torque T Coulomb that we are going to apply. Okay, this comes from your magnetocoulombic actuator. Okay. And then in the analysis, instead of using theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, the Euler's angles, in this analysis quaternions have been used, q 1, q 2, q 3, q 4, something like that. These are the quaternions have been used in the analysis, and the rates of the quaternion vector is related to the angular velocity vector. So, this is actually a kinematic equation, and this equation actually we considered in the previous lectures in terms q 1 2. So, this is the equation of motion, and basically we are going to deal with this Coulombic actuator torques. So, this is the torque due to the Lorentz force, and as I mentioned just a few minutes ago, if there is a particle that has charge q is moving with velocity v in the magnetic field, this one here is the force applied, force acting on that charge. Okay. So, this particle having this charge is subjected to this force. Okay. So, if you have several charges as we have over here, each of these charges will be subjected to some forces. Okay. And then when they are subject to these forces, so this is subject to some force and this one will be subjected to another force, this is q x, this is q x minus. So, you get a moment from this. So, the torque is r cross f, and you have to sum this for all these particles. So, this r cross f is for one charge q. So, you calculate this moment for each charge and sum them up. So, this r here is the position vector of a specific charge, let us say this, with respect to the central mass of the system. So, r cross f, f is this. So, this is the torque. Okay. Now, if you write down these components, this r, this is actually a vector r x r y r z, column vector r x r y r z, or usually people write also x y z. So, this has components r x r y r z, then b also has components b x b y b z, and then similarly v. So, if you evaluate this, you are going to have a quantity, this torque, which will be related to, of course, this q x q I q z, because this the r, this r and q, they have been multiplied, this is a matrix product, you get this quantity. Then you have this v cross b, that is over there, and then if you do the algebra, take the cross product and so on, the cross products, when you have this cross product v cross b, you can change that into minus b cross v, or you can just actually say that this torque is this cross product of that. So, if you take this as one vector, b cross b is a vector, so you can actually say that this is equal to minus b cross b cross this quantity. So, that is what is written over there. This q symmetric matrix is arising because of this v cross b vector. So, the argument here is this vector v cross b. So, T Coulomb is S v cross b times d q. And so these have been written here explicitly as v cross b. V cross b you can calculate, and then its x y z components, when you put in the right order, this is what you will get. So, this is S v cross b, this quantity, and then this d and q are arising from this distances and the charges. Yeah. So, this D is a diagonal R x, R y, R z. This is actually written in this form. This is actually a square matrix with the diagonal R x, R y, R z, and this Q is a vector, Q x, Q y, Q z vector, is a column vector. Now, you have to understand that this T Coulomb is a column vector. This S is, this is a square matrix 3 by 3. D is a square matrix 3 by 3 diagonal square matrix, and Q is a vector. So, you know, when you multiply this out, square matrix times a vector, you get a vector T Coulomb. Okay. So, you know, this is, you know, a convenient way of writing this product. Okay. Now, again, you see that this T Coulomb, the torque that you get from this this Coulombic system will not have a component along B cross B, because T is this quantity cross B cross B. So, T is perpendicular to this vector B cross B. If you call B cross B as a new vector, let us call this vector Z. Okay. In that case, T is perpendicular to vector Z. So, T will not have any component along vector Z B cross B. So, this is similar to when we are studying magnetotorquers. T cannot have very arbitrary value, but it has some restriction that it cannot have any component along vector Z. If I call this as B cross B as vector Z, it will not have any component along that vector. It is perpendicular to that vector, similar to what we saw for the magnetotorquers. And just like we got the solution using a pseudo inverse for magnetotorquers, here also you have to calculate the solution using pseudo inverse of this S. So, pseudo inverse of this. So, the T Coulomb is equal to that. Basically, what we are trying to find out is that what will be these charges. If you need certain control torque, what charges do we need? This is the problem. So, you want to calculate this Q knowing what kind of control torque you require. This control torque is evaluated in the same manner as the magnetotorquers. You know, you have the Euler's equations and you decide what control law you choose. You choose a control law. Based on that control law choice, you find out the control torque. So, this torque, you know what torque you want to use. And you want to find out what charges should be there. So, the charges that you will have, you know, when you try to invert this, you know, pseudo inverse, you will come actually, you know, this you will have a D inverse coming in and then pseudo inverse of that. So, you will have a D inverse and then pseudo inverse of that multiplied by the control torque, that will be the charges required. So, you should have this charge. Okay. And so, this S of this pseudo inverse is basically the transpose of this matrix divided by the norm of this argument, similar to before one. Okay. So, you get the solution in terms of transpose. So, it is very similar to what we did in the first hour, but it is a little bit more complicated, and physical system is different, but lot of mathematics is similar.
Sir, I have a doubt. How is it different? There also magnetotorquers also we have a current going. Mm-hmm. That means there is charge moving.
Mm. Here we have only static charge. So physically is different in the sense that we have static charge, the skews. So charges are not moving in a loop. So in those coils, charges were moving in that loop, in that wire, okay, in that coil. So charges are moving. Plus, the whole charge was also moving in an orbit. Okay, the system is moving, but here the charges are static charges, and the static charges are moving in an orbit. There is no current here. Okay, so physically that is the difference. So you have a static charge.
Passing through any wire?
No, there is no wire. So basically, what you have is you have a satellite, and then far away. Okay, here. So you have this satellite, and at a certain distance, you put a shell. Okay, and make that cell electrically charged. So you have some static charge there. Similarly, you have five other cells there. So these are all statically charged. Okay, these are all static charges, and these charges could be actually significant, you know, not small charges, you know, if you want to, but there are practically you can implement them, but these are not small charges. Okay.
So there will be a dielectric medium in between, and it should pass like a electric discharge kind of thing.
Electric discharge, I mean, there is that a discharge? I do not think there is a discharge.
If you are putting two shells,
yes,
then if the charge has to move from one shell,
but they are not,
it has to move through a dielectric medium,
yes.
So, okay, it is sort of a current only. I am not able to understand how is it
different. Well, this is electrostatic attraction. You can have electrostatic attraction, but there is no current there, really. Is there, Dr. Sinha? There is no current as far as I. No.
Whatever, so we can have two electron guns or whatever the possibility. Here the cells are there, and we are firing electrons over that.
Right.
They are gaining some charges.
So they have some starters, and you maintain the charge.
Move through the charge will move through. The
charge is not moving. Through the
charge is not. Once you fire from the electron gun, can be positioned just near the cell.
So there is no current flow here.
The current is very
negligible.
It has to go, so it's a very feeble current.
Yeah, it's negligible. So that's not really contributing to your torque. It's just the fact that there are static charges, and you have an electric gun. You then charge your surfaces using that electric gun, but there is no current flow from one charge to the other. Negligible. So we are not. We don't need to deal with the dielectric medium or anything like that.
Then how is this v term coming?
This velocity is because of the orbital motion. This one is moving around the Earth.
But it will produce a force that will change the orbital motion of the vehicle. Right?
The orbital motion of the vehicle also. Yeah, also can affect, but if you balance these forces, you can actually make such that one force will be one direction, the other one will be in the opposite direction. So, the net force as far as the orbital motion is concerned can be zero, okay, but they can give rise to a torque. So, imagine when you have the thrusters, okay, in thruster control. So, you have a body and you have two thrusters, you apply the thrust in opposite direction, so that the net thrust on the center mass is zero, but they give rise to a torque. So this v that you have here, this v is the velocity of the system around the Earth, because the whole thing is moving around the Earth. That's why you have the v. Okay, it's not the v of the charge going from here to here. No, it's the v because of the orbital motion. Okay. So you can actually then solve for the charge, okay, using from this equation, q hat is given by that, and you can get that this q charge is related to the control torque that you need through this pseudo inverse that you have. Okay, so now I had called this v cross b, I said that call it a z vector, but in this, but call it p vector now, because this is what in this analysis I've said. So if you call this v cross b, give it a new name, p vector in this analysis, and then the unit vector of this p would be this p vector divided by the magnitude of p. So this p vector divided by magnitude of p is a unit vector sigma, and this unit vector sigma will have components along the body frame, and we call them as sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. Okay, so that the expressions that we had before, this we can rewrite using the fact that now this v cross b is called as p vector. In terms of p vector, we can now rewrite the results. The t coulomb can be written in terms of this p vector, and qx, qy, qz can be written in terms of this modulus of this p vector. Okay, so this has been done, in terms of the components of the p vectors and p vector. So basically, the results that we had here this is just rewritten in terms of P now. Okay. So, this Q x Q y Q z is a D inverse, like this D inverse times S transpose of P vector divided by P square times U. This is what we have over here. So, this is another way of writing using the P vector. Now, as I said, I think this is B cross B.
B cross B.
Yeah, the B is missing. So, this is actually the direction of the P vector, B cross B. So, this is the direction of the P vector. And your torques that you can generate lie in this plane that is perpendicular to this P vector. It is the same diagram that we had. So, we had there the B vector, now we have the P vectors. So, the torque that we produce using electrostatic actuators, using Lorentz vector, torques will be lying in this plane. The torque is a vector. So, the Coulombic vector will lie in this direction. So, this is B cross B. So, V is in this direction as well, because V is perpendicular to B cross B. So, V also lies in this plane, Coulombic torque vector also lies in this plane. So, if you want to generate this U, okay, not so you cannot have actually U, any arbitrary U obtained from T Coulomb, that is not possible, just we said. So, we can actually get a best, you know, the best possible value, okay, in this plane, but we cannot generate arbitrary U using Coulombic actuators. And so this is again written Euler's equation, gravity gradient terms, disturbance, and this is the control torque. Okay. The control torque T Coulomb, which was this S sigma transpose U, like over here, S sigma transpose, we had that Coulomb in terms of S transpose U divided by this P. This can be rewritten in terms of this, in terms of sigma hat, because sigma hat is the unit vector along P. So, this is equivalent to the expression that we had. And let us call this product of these two matrices as another matrix psi, which is dependent on the components of the unit vector along B cross P. So, you can write this T Coulomb in psi sigma, and this is the Coulombic torque. So, the Euler's equation looks like that. All right. Now, there are some issues, you know, some detailed theoretical issues also that have been considered, and this psi says that this is proposed magnetic Coulombic actuating system is almost similar to the magnetic control system, like the the magnetotorquers that we said. So, this is what it says over here. So, that the control torque lies perpendicular to the magnetic field vector, just like, you know, we had the control torque perpendicular to magnetic field vector in the magnetotorquer case, here is the same thing. So, I have already said that. So, magnetotorquer had no component along B, here the Coulombic actuating system has no component along vector P, which is B cross B, that is what we are saying. So, so if you call that SSB as gamma, so for a magnetically actuated satellite, you know, there is some theorem. It says that the magnetic satellite attitude system will be controllable on an average. So this is actually for this is for magnetotorquers. Okay, same thing. You can use same type of relation for the Coulombic actuator system, that on the average you can control the attitude of the satellite in all three directions on the average, but you cannot actually have any component along B cross B, but you can just like you cannot have any component along B for the magnetotorquer case. But for magnetotorquers, it has been proved that you can have three axis stabilization. Here also you can have three axis stabilization in the same sense. And so, these are actually the results, they have been actually proven, and we do not have to actually go through the proofs over here, it is not that important for us. Okay. So, there are we are going to basically consider the concepts, but not the mathematical proofs, because there is mathematical proofs. You know, this one, are you going to send this to every to all the students? So,
it will be tough to
understand. Exactly, because there is a lot of mathematics, only probably some of you can understand, but if you are, you know, an M-Tech student, you may not be able to understand all these things. So, it is not necessary, you just have to get the idea basically, not the mathematical proofs, not necessary. Okay. So, here this is a what we are going to talk about is that, you know, show some results. So, this is actually the control system block using quaternions, not the Pizzarelli angles. So, you have the quaternions and the angular velocity components here, these are the required ones, and then you have this actual q r and omega r and the actual ones, and then they are subtracted from the desired ones, you get some error in the quaternions and angular velocity, then you use this controller, develop a control law, whatever control law you want to use, PID or nonlinear control law, whatever, and then you know what control torque you need, and then from control torque you can find out what charge you need using this relation, where this one here, you know, q 1 in terms of u, you calculate this using the controller and then you find out what charges you need. So, you calculate what charges you need, these charges will then generate some torque when you apply these charges. So, basically, you know, these charges will be time dependent. So, you have to change the charges using some electric gun or something, so that these are time dependent, and then this is applied to the satellite, and then you get QR and omega. So this is the basically the control system block. So now let us consider a circular polar orbit of radius 7000 kilometers. This is typically what happens in a sun synchronous satellite. Many of the remote sensing satellites, they have near polar orbit, not exactly polar, but close to polar orbit, maybe 96 degrees, 97 degrees inclination, the altitudes are typically 600 700 800 kilometers for all these remote sensing satellites like IRS and so on. Okay. Now, there have been several remote sensing satellites launched by India. IRS is an old one, you know, and the names of the new ones I cannot remember.
Cartosat,
yes, Cartosat is a recent one. Okay. So, as I said, these remote sensing satellites have near polar orbits 96, 97, 98 degrees inclination to the equator. So, here the inclination is 97.8 degrees, okay, and altitude is slightly less than 600 and some kilometers altitude, okay, and the magnetic field, you see, this magnetic field has to be calculated, okay, because the magnetic field is not the same all over around the earth. So, using this international geomagnetic, you know, this IGRF, magnetic fields were calculated, and then he said that there is a small disturbance torque which has a steady component and a component that varies at the same with the same period as the orbital period, because there are some components which are steady, let us say solar radiation pressure as a steady component. but you may have variable components. If you have, for example, sometimes aerodynamic torques can have a variable component change with orbits. You know, if you have small eccentricity, they can change with orbits. Or and then these disturbance torques were applied. You know, this actually is a Newton meter, not Newton meter square. So it's a Newton meter, and then charges are assumed to be separated by unit distance. So the distance between the cells from positive Qx and Qx minus, the distance is unit distance, or is this unit distance between the center of mass and the charge, or between Qx and Qx minus?
It's between the two cells.
Okay, so this is the from the center of mass will be about half of that. Okay, so the spacecraft has these kind of moments of inertia. The two examples are considered. This is one space moments of one set of moments of inertia, and then some initial conditions were given to yaw, pitch, and roll, and to the these are the yaw, pitch, and roll, and from there you can calculate Q naught. Yeah, you convert them into quaternions. The calculations were done using quaternions. Okay, so these were converted into quaternions, and these are the initial angular velocities.
One is quite close to the
orbital angular velocities is about 0.1.
Another one is around 63.
So these are of the same order as orbital angular velocity. Orbital angular velocity for 7000 kilometer will be approximately 1.2 times 10 to the power of minus 3 approximately. So they are of the same order. And then some gains Kp and Kb. So PD control was used. So you calculate U based on the PD control, and there was some limit put on how what will be the maximum charge. You know, beyond that, you know, you just maintain that charge until you know you get some control. So this is the limit on the charge that you apply to the shells. So this is one case, and similarly the other case. So the limit is the same. Kp, Kb were different. Here, these two, the satellite is the same as I can see, because same moments of inertia. The differences were actually in the angular velocity, basically in the angular velocity initial conditions. The quaternions initial conditions are the same, but you know this corresponds to initial conditions where the angular velocity components are of the same order as the orbital angular velocity. And here they are, you know, it's like a spinning satellite. This is about 100 times the orbital angular velocity in radians a second. So two cases were considered, and the results we can see. Okay, so these are the initial conditions for the quaternions, like these ones here. So the results you can see. This is for the first case where we had small angular velocity excursions, and you can see that using the Coulombic control, you can control this, but of course all these controls like magnetotorquers or Coulombic control, they have slow response. So as you can see here, it takes a couple of orbits or more, actually three orbits or so, before it settles down to the desired value. Okay, so it takes some time, but this is to be expected. Anytime you use Lorentz force or or magnetotorquers, you will have to wait, you have to have patience. And here these are the angular velocity components correspond to this quaternions, and these are the charges that are required. The maximum charge that was allowed was 0.05 coulomb. So at one point here it reaches the limit, but otherwise the charges are fairly small, except in some places, you know, they could be a little high, but this is the limit. So you can see that with the limit on the charges, that you put as a constraint, you can control the attitude of the satellites fairly well, except that, you know, this kind of actuators have slow response like magneto torquers, but the control is quite good. And this is now the case where you have the same satellite, same initial condition for the quaternions, but the angular velocities initial conditions are different. So, you know, you have a very large rotations relatively. So, here also you can control them, but you have large oscillations over here. The reason why you have, you know, all these oscillations in Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 is because you have all these large angular velocities. Angular velocities are related to Q dots. So, Q dots are related to angular velocity components. If you have large angular velocity components, you are going to have also large Q1s also. Q1s are going to change very quickly. So, you will have lot of oscillations in Q1 because your Q1 dot is large. So, you will have oscillations, but these oscillations after some time they decay, and you can see that after a couple of orbit, 2.5 orbits or so, you have basically, you know, no attitude variation from the desired ones. And here again, you know, omega x, as you can see, you know, this omega x, omega y, they were 0.1 radian per second. 0.1 radian per second is roughly about 5.5 degrees per second. So, they start a little high, you know, and then they die down. These angular velocity components die down quite fast, you know, unlike this Q1s over here. And these are the charges. So, here you can see that there are many instances where you hit the limit of the charge, but after that, you know, you do not apply any extra charge. So, let the satellite has its own dynamics, but eventually the charges are sufficient to make the attitude go to the desired attitude. Okay. So, here this actually plots the eigenvalues of this matrix here, the psi c. This is actually you know, the product of those two skew matrices, okay, in terms of the unit vectors components, unit vectors of B cross B components. And these matrix eigenvalues, you can see how they vary over there. For the two cases, this is for the
different angular velocity.
This is actually 0.001 radian per second is for the first case that we had, but you know, different angular velocities have been considered here. And you have the eigenvalues here. In one case, the eigenvalue
average eigenvalues. So, irrespective of the angular velocity, they converge to the same value. That was proved.
That was proved, yes. So, this is actually to basically related to the stability. Okay. So, this is the controllability of the magnetic coulombic system. So, there are some theorems that have been proved, which we do not want to go through, because it will be too much for us here.
This sliding mode control.
I just want to show them some results. So, here basically, you know, a sliding mode control was developed, and then we had a PID control. This is a PD control. So, the goal was here to see how sliding mode control performs relative to the PD control. PD control, you know, the results that we saw earlier were for PD control. So, now there will be a comparison. And the same initial conditions for the quaternions, the same spacecraft, and here, of course, you know, these are for omega hat radian per second. This is the initial angular velocity components, and these are some constants related to the sliding mode control. This KQ and KP. Kp and Kv are for the PD control. So, there were some other constants over here for the sliding mode control, but here the limits have been put actually a little bit high here, 1.2 coulomb. I don't know why 0.5 coulomb. Oh, it's just arbitrary, I guess.
Except if we keep a higher limit, so it will converge quickly.
Yes,
if
of course. Take, no, no. What I'm saying is that we know that if instead of 0.5, if you have 1.5, it will happen. So why 0.5 was not considered? What
it's
happened?
Arbitrary.
It's arbitrary. It would have been interesting to compare with the same 0.5, but it doesn't matter.
In the same thing, that Q limit, we can see that there is 0.1 also.
So this is a smaller one. So
charge limit is 0.1. Yeah. So correspondingly, if we reduce the limit, so we have to increase the distance between the cells. So distance between the cells has been made 12 meters. And upper one, it's a 1.2 coulomb, the charge is there. So distance is 1. So if we multiply that, it comes in the equation there,
right?
D and Q, so it's
right,
the same.
Right. So if you have lower limit, you have to have higher distance. So this is 12 meter.
So the performance because you have will remain same, irrespective
right.
of this.
DQ DQ has to be the same for the same response.
Same response.
Yeah. DQ has to be same. So here we have. I don't know.
Left hand side is the sliding control, and
right hand side
is
for the
PD
control. So here, they are basically of the basically similar, but PD control is not controlled as quickly as the sliding mode control over here. This the performance of the sliding mode control is slightly better than the PD control, except that in terms of the you can see that even if you want to see how quickly it goes to the desired attitude, here it does better than here. Here you still have some remnants here for PD control. So sliding control works better than PD control in several aspects. So this is what you see, and this is for quaternions. And what is more important is the quaternion, how the quaternions compare as opposed to the angular velocity comparison. So here you can see that sliding mode control has better performance than the PD control. And corresponding to those two, the charges also have been compared, and you can see that sliding mode control has better performance in terms of charges than the PD control. And the torques are comparable, but here you have very oscillatory torque, basically because your charges have to be varied like that. So it will be better not to reach the limit of the charge. Here you never reach the limit of the charge in the sliding mode control, but here you hit the limit many times in the PD control. So basically, if you use a better control law, you have better performance. That's basically the key point. This is actually what is required in the two cases. Here you require much more power in PD control than in the sliding mode control. So this is for the second case. Basic conclusions are similar for both of them.
Because the distance
and QD is the same, so basically
the charge limit has been reduced,
so you won't get anything. Because the QD, once the product QD is the same, you are not changing anything.
Yeah,
it's the same problem.
So therefore, exactly the same graph.
So it's just actually it actually establishes that it does not matter whether you change Q or you change D, as long as QD is the same, the product is the same, results are the same. And this is the same sequence, same simulation for the second case, comparing the two types of control and the power. Okay. Now, what you are considering is that if some of the cells, there is actually a failure. Okay. So this is the same equation that we had seen before, and then the A1 and A2. So what is happening is that you don't have any sigma z.
Here, the that sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, those are
the B cross B components.
Vector. Uh-huh. So we are defining these two vectors.
So this B cross B vector.
Two orthogonal vectors.
Okay.
Lying in the plane, so this A.
Okay, so you are defining two vectors A1 and A2 in this plane.
Yeah.
A1, A2.
These two are orthogonal. And we have to prove that the system is fault tolerant, means even if one of the actuator fails, so using the two remaining actuators, we get the same kind of performance.
Oh, well, you get comparable performance, not same performance,
same
comparable.
Performance provided we modulate the charge.
Modulate the charge, yeah. Okay, so this is actually the proof.
This is the proof for that.
Proof for that, and then you have the results. Okay, so here you have some limit. Now this is using PD control again, because you have KP and KV using PD control.
This part is not done for the sliding control, only
for the PD control. Yeah, this is only the PD control, and there are some initial velocity, initial conditions for the quaternions and the angular velocities. And here you are considering now a satellite where the principal axis is not along the principal axis. Okay. And you have the Q limit. This is Q. What are these two things? Q limit.
If we scale the charge, because once the failure takes place, so we have to increase the charge limit.
To 1.8 to 5.5.
So more charge modulation basically. So that the torque then remains the same.
Okay.
If two of them are working just now, so we have to increase the charge so that the total torque provided.
It remains
on
the same.
Average,
yeah.
It will be the same.
Yeah. On the average, it will remain the same. So there has been a failure of which one did you consider?
Z
direction. So, okay. So there is a failure in the Z direction. Only X and Y were happening. So you have three cases over here. So this is for no failure case. Which one is no failure
first
case?
First one is for no failure.
No failure case.
The rest two are for the failure case. One is for keeping the charge.
Charge same, and another one modulated.
Modulated charge.
So okay, so here we say this is the performance without any failure. This is the performance with the same charge, no modulation. And in fact, even with this. Even with failure with no modulation, the results are very comparable to that. It is not actually that bad.
Because and it's a 2x control.
2x control, yeah. So if you modulate, you get better control, because these ones the
oscillations reduce.
In fact, also there is actually slightly better performance in terms of when you hit the attitude become almost
because
negligible.
The charge limit
now is higher. So this is these are for the quaternions, they are for the angular velocities, same type of conclusions, and these are the charges. Here the charges with no failure, you know, you have actually better performance, but when you have failure, you get some type of performance for quaternions, but you need to hit the limit of the charges in some cases.
So here the jet charge QZ is 0.
Yeah, because that this has failed. So this QZ is 0 in both of them. So this is with modulation, this is without modulation. Without modulation, you actually hit all these limits a few more times. So that's about that. And these are the torque components and the power. The power without failure, of course, you know, you use less power compared to the case where there is a failure and no modulation. But here I see that you need sometimes more power, even, you know, when modulated.
Charge is more,
so you need more power. But is this preferable to that? With, you know, I mean, if you want to have less power, you may like to have this kind of behavior, lower power, with probably a slightly slower response, as opposed to this one when you need more power, but you will have a faster response.
This has been, if we want the same kind of performance, so we have to increase the Q. Now,
if you increase the Q, power will increase.
Power will increase, because in this case, Q we have increased to a higher limit. Okay, so and therefore, if we multiply with the T times this theta dot.
Well, that yes, that is fine. But what is actually point that can be discussed is that whether you want slightly better or slightly faster response with more power, or you want slightly slower response with you know lower power. So this is actually you know something depending on it probably depends on your mission. So you can increase it. So basically, what it says is that you can control a satellite's attitude in all three directions using Coulombic actuators, even though Coulombic actuators do not have component in a particular direction. You can still control in all three axes. And what it also it shows that sliding mode control has better behavior than PD control. Well, you know this is normally the case in all systems. Sliding mode control will perform better than ordinary PD control. Although the ordinary PD control, simple PD control is quite often good enough, as we saw, it actually works. So sliding mode control has better response than PD control. And also what Dr. Sinha and his student, now Dr. Giri, have shown is that even if there is a failure, that means in, even if you have QZ is equal to 0, still you would be able to control the system. Even if you don't increase the charges, you can still control with a slightly inferior response. And you can actually have very good response if you increase the charges, even when there is a failure. So QZ is 0, only QX and QY are available. So that's all they have done. So these are the closing comments of Dr. Sinha and Dr. Giri, that they obtained a dynamical model for Coulomb cells attached to the three body axis of the satellite and calculated what charge is required when you have a specific control torque requirement. And then they proved rigorously the controllability of this these actuators, magneto-coulombic actuators, then also proved that you can have, well, they derived a sliding mode control also, which worked better. They also proved that even when you have failure, you can provide attitude control using this system. So the system is fault tolerant. So this is a fault tolerant attitude control. So that's all that we have here. So thank you very much, Dr. Sinha, for providing this and to show you know what you are doing.
Important point was that if we have a sphere as a satellite, so having the principal axis, this inertia the same in the three directions, say 120, 120, 120, the diagonal terms. So using two x control, we can some other control, say the control moment gyros or any other control, with the 2x control we cannot perform. But using this magneto-coulombic or the magnetic actuators, this 2x control we can do even for this what we call as the iso inertia case.
Right.
So that was the advantage.
That's the advantage. Mm-hmm. Except that, you know, in practice you will not have
in iso inertia practice case. Not have that kind of case.
Thanks. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention and coming and listening to me, and I really appreciate your interest here. Thank you very much.